Sorry, I have a different mic on than usual. Thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, welcome to St. John's. I'm Kristen Dollar, and I welcome you on behalf of our pastoral team here, Dr. Tim McClendon and Reverend Nancy Reed. Tim is actually out of town for Labor Day weekend. He's visiting his daughter, Narcy, and his grandkids in Florida. So Nancy will be preaching for us this morning, and Chuck Carver is playing the piano. So we're grateful to have both of them here. And at this time, I invite you to stand and sing hymn number 160, Rejoice, Ye Pure in Heart. Be seated. Together, let us join in our opening prayer, which is printed in the bulletin. Let us pray. O God, creator of the universe, holy and all-powerful, you have approached us even in our unworthiness and have shown us the face of your love, Jesus, your Son, our Savior. As your Son revealed your love and mercy by serving others and accepting them as people made in your image and likeness, may we model ourselves after that image. May this time of worship be a true reflection of our thanksgiving, wonder, and praise over such blessings. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, welcome to St. John's. I invite you at this time to take the friendship pad, which is located in the center aisle, and pass it all the way down the row. This helps us to keep up with you and to stay in contact throughout the week. A very important reminder that Wednesday night supper and fellowship starts this Wednesday. So if you have not already RSVP'd, you can make a note in the friendship pad or you can call the church office. I'm very excited. This will be my first Wednesday night supper and gathering, and fellowship is absolutely, considering this theological significance of communion, fellowship and time together eating and drinking is a very important part in the life of the church. And now I would like to invite Rob Braithwaite to come forward and to share a message about Disciple One.
Good morning, St. John's. Just want to take a moment to make a pitch, for the Disciple Bible Study. What is it? Disciple Bible Study is a tried and tested method of reading and studying the Bible from Genesis to Revelations. And we're going to start on the 16th of September, that is a week from this Wednesday, following the Wednesday night supper. And it will last for 34 weeks, a significant undertaking, you may say. Well, yes, I would agree with you. But anything worth doing is worth doing well. And if you're going to read the whole Bible, well, I would suggest to you that this is a wonderful way to do it. So who might be a candidate to be in the Disciple Bible Study class? If you've ever put it on your bucket list that you might like to read this book from beginning to end, you might be a candidate for Disciple Bible Study. If your Bible looks like you just took it off the shelf from the Christian bookstore and you want it to look more well used, you just might be a candidate. But more importantly, if you have felt the leanings and the urgings of the Holy Spirit to get closer to Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior, then I would suggest that you would make an excellent candidate for Disciple Bible Study. If you are interested, I would ask that you let Reverend Nancy Reed know, or you can call me at my office. I'm going to give you that number. And please, if you're not doing it, just pretend like you're writing it down so it'll make me feel better. It's 649-4144. That's 649-4144. And if you are interested, please, for heaven's sakes, give us a call, and I hope that you will prayerfully consider joining us. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rob. And now at this time, let us stand for the affirmation of faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
As we continue to worship, as we pray. Dear gracious God, we gather in this gym, which is our sanctuary for now. And not too many years ago, this was the place where we welcomed the evacuees from Katrina, our guest, over 10 years ago. Thank you for the leaders of this church and the many from the community who stepped up and made a temporary home for those who had lost everything. We're always reminded that you, Lord, are with us through the storms of life and through the good times. Thank you for the ways that we were touched and changed by those who came here scared and afraid. Help us to not forget that we are to reach out to those in need. Help us to open our doors and hearts to those in this area and those around the world, to the children in Kenya, to those families in Honduras, those young people, girls in Thailand. Lord, there's so much in the world that we don't understand, but we can help them know you, and through that knowledge, they will be able to deal with the storms that come their way. Thank you for St. John's. Keep us looking out and not in just inward. Today, there are those who are worried about the future, anxious because of illness or upcoming surgeries or recovery from surgery. All of this brings changes to our lives, to our daily lives, that are so hard to deal with, Lord. Today, we ask that you be with each one. Today, we can turn to you, Lord, when we are uncertain of our next step. We pray for our communities as they cope with acts of violence and the constant worry of what will happen next. Help us to live and love as Jesus did, and to forgive as Jesus did, even on the cross. Now, as your children, we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now we invite our ushers to come forward to receive a portion of what we have been given by God.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassion, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faith. kindness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings are mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord.
At this time, we invite our children to follow the crucifer to Children's Church as we sing our hymn of preparation, number 273, Jesus' Hands Were Kind Hands.
Thank you.
remain standing for our scripture this morning. Our scripture comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 7, verses 24 through 37. From there he set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know he was there yet. And yet he could not escape notice. But a woman whose daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him. And she came and bowed down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile of Syrophoenician origin. She begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. And he said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." But she answered him, "Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." And then he said to her, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." So she went home and found the child lying on the bed, and the demon was gone. Our second account of healing is where Jesus cures a deaf man. Then he returned from the region of Tyre and went by way of Sidon toward the Sea of Galilee in the region of the Decapolis. They brought to him a deaf man who had an impediment in his speech, and they begged him to lay his hand on him. Jesus took him aside in private and away from the crowd and put his fingers in his ears, and he spat and touched his tongue. Then, looking up to heaven, he sighed and said to him, "Ephphatha," that is, "be opened." And immediately his ears were open, his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. Then Jesus ordered them to tell no one. But the more he ordered them, the more zealously they proclaimed it. They were astounded beyond measure, saying, "He has done everything well. He even makes the deaf to hear and the mute to speak." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Be seated. This morning, before I start with the message, I would like to just take a moment and thank you as a congregation. Thank you for your support in my journey into the ministry. Many of you I've known for many years, and I am so grateful for that. I would like to tell you I have completed the first year of my coursework this past summer, and my grades were sufficient that I will move on to year two. So they were good. So thank you. Our scripture today is found in the Gospel of Mark. It's believed to have been written around 65 to 70 AD. We don't really know if Mark was really the author, but he's credited with writing this book. And it's believed to be written for a Gentile audience, not for the Jewish people, because there's a lot of explanation in Mark of customs that would be familiar to the Jewish people. These are healings, these are miracles. They're not the ones that we are most familiar with. This is from the lectionary. The lectionary is the calendar of texts that ministers can use or not use, but I will tell you that when I was reading about this text, the lectionary actually said, "This is really one that some people might just skip over." But I thought, well, we'll just dig into it and see where we can go with it. In these passages, Jesus has left Galilee and traveled to a region that he's not familiar with. This is a region of other people, of Gentiles. And it seems that Jesus has gone to this first location to get away, We don't really know why he has gone there. But a woman from that region comes up to him and asks him to help her daughter. This mother is on a mission because her daughter is possessed by a demon. Clearly, Jesus' reputation goes beyond the area of Galilee because this woman knows who he is and knows that he can heal people. When this woman speaks to Jesus, his first response is rather harsh. And at first he refuses to heal her child. Now, we have to remember that Jesus is Jewish and that Jesus really was coming to the chosen people. Now, if that was the end of the story, we would really be upset and we wouldn't be here today. But there's more to this story, more than just the healing that goes on. Why is Jesus harsh to the woman? We don't really know all those answers. I mean, could it be he was trying to get away? Maybe he was on a little vacation with the disciples. Have you ever gone somewhere thinking, well, I'm going to get away from Achan and the people I know here? And lo and behold, there's people who know you and people who come up to you and interrupt that quiet time that you were expecting to have. Sometimes, and that might be what happened to Jesus. But probably, I would say it's really more that Jesus is just doing what Jesus does best. He knows the heart of the people who he encounters. And so he knows the heart of this woman who has come to him. We can imagine being the parent of a child who is sick. Some of you may have lived that life. And you would be desperate to find healing for them. We haven't really seen Jesus refuse someone in the way that he seems to almost do in this passage. But then the woman kind of turns the table on Jesus with her comments in much the same way that Jesus sometimes turns the table on the Pharisees. Jesus has told her, "I must help my own family, the Jewish people, and cannot give their food to the dogs," thinking, referring to the Gentiles. Food the children of Israel need, but the dogs can eat what the children have dropped under the table. So that's what the woman says back to Jesus, that, you know, the food can be given to the children, but the crumbs will be eaten by the dogs. Miracles, accounts of healing. The obvious one in this first passage is the healing of the child. But we must look beyond the obvious. What could be the message Jesus intends for his disciples and for us today? Could the real miracle be overcoming prejudices and boundaries that separate people? This exchange between Jesus and the Gentile woman shows us the future when Gentiles are included and that their faith can bring them salvation. Now, where were the disciples sent to take the message out? At first, it was to the lost sheep of Israel, not the Gentiles. But Jesus changed that with this scripture in Mark. The Gentiles and all who come to know Christ can receive what was intended only for God's chosen people. At first glance, we are still maybe a little uncomfortable that the original plan included only the chosen. But we know the good news of the grace of God shown in Jesus. And the door is open and we can all be saved. In our second portion of the scripture, the man who could not speak well and was deaf was brought to Jesus by his friends. We don't really know if he was Gentile or Jew. Jesus took him to a private place, and he touches the man's ears and tongue, and healing occurs. Now, this is a little different from the little girl. She's healed, and Jesus doesn't even see her. He doesn't go to her. He doesn't see her. So Jesus heals in different ways. But with the man, also Jesus tells his friends and him not to tell anyone. But we do have a lot of details, so I think we can safely assume that it was told. The man who cannot hear and had difficulty speaking, he is healed by Jesus. We might wonder why Jesus told them not to tell. Maybe that was just he knew human nature and they would tell more. We're kind of like that. If we're told not to tell something, I don't know. Maybe we tell it even more. I recently, this spring, purchased an iPhone. Now, many of you have had iPhones for years, but I just got mine, and one of the apps I have on my iPhone is a vocabulary word. I receive a new vocabulary word every day. And the one that came yesterday, now I'd already worked on this message, but maybe this is God speaking a little bit. The word was ear witness. Have you ever heard of ear witness? Well, evidently in the 1500s, when eyewitness became a popular word or a part of the English, a part of the vocabulary, ear witness was also a word that was used. Well, we know that we've not heard of ear witness, so eyewitness, we know what that means. You see with your eyes and you witness it and tell others. Well, in this story about the man who was deaf, maybe he's really an ear witness because he's now going to be able to hear and he's going to be able to witness. So you have a new word to try on your friends. You can say, well, I'll be your ear witness. What might the themes to these scriptures be? For the first one, we really are assured that the good news is for all, not just the chosen. And more specifically, not just for those here at St. John's, not for those just in the United Methodist Church, not just here in Aiken, but the good news is for everyone around the world. There's a story online that I had copied and pasted into a file a long time ago, and I found it. It's called Invisible Moms. I couldn't find an author, so I don't know who, and I don't know if it could be fiction. But it goes like this, and I'll tell it as a mom. It all began to make sense. The blank stares, the lack of response, the way Addie, who's my daughter, walked into the room while I was on the phone and asked to be taken to the store. Does that sound familiar? Inside, I'm thinking, can't you see I'm on the phone? Of course not. No one can see if I'm on the phone or cooking dinner or cleaning the house or even standing upside down in the corner. Although I can't do that. I'm invisible. I'm the invisible mom. Some days, I'm only a pair of hands to fix things. Or iron something, or wash something. Can you open this? Some days I'm more like a clock. How much longer do I have till I leave for school or on a trip? How much further is it? How long do we have to go? One night, I'm out to eat with friends, and one friend has been on a trip. She's been to Europe and seen wonderful things, talked to people, been on a grand adventure. And I think, what have I done lately? Where have I been? The others at dinner all look so put together. These women. And I just put on the first clean outfit I can find. And it's a little out of style. But my friend who went on the trip hands me a gift. And I open it. And it's a book about the great cathedrals of Europe. And I'm thinking, I don't know why this friend gave me this book about the great cathedrals. But I open the book, and the inscription reads, "To my friend, with admiration for the greatness of what you are building when no one sees." To my friend, with admiration for the greatness of what you are building when no one sees. Now, in this book, there were four life-changing messages. One, no one can say who built the great cathedrals. We don't know their names. Two, the builders gave their whole lives for a work that they would never see completed. Third, they made great sacrifices and expected no credit. The passion of their building was fueled by their faith that the eyes of God saw everything. There was a legend in the book of a rich man who came to visit one of the cathedrals as it was being built. And there was a workman who was carving a bird on a beam. Now, I don't know if any carving could have been done on these beams, but maybe a workman put something up there. But the workman was carving this bird, and the rich man said to him, "Why are you spending your time carving a bird, a beautiful bird, where no one will see it?" And the workman responds, "Because God sees." If we see ourselves as builders of something, maybe someone, or something that we won't even see completed. There were builders here at St. John's who dreamed of those who would be here today. Those who built that small first white church that faced Richland Avenue. There's a replica in the area outside Ward Hall where the coffee house is. Some of you worship there, I'm sure. Some of you may have had weddings there or had family who were married or baptized there. Then there were those who built the sanctuary in the education building. Probably more of you were part of that dream. And then the Ebenezer building, this building, the gym, the preschool, the second floor. And then just last spring, the Faith Center. And now the renovations to our sanctuary. Certainly there are many who were part of the building of St. John's, and some who did not see each of those phases completed that they saw started. And many, even as recently as last year, who may have been part of this congregation when we started the building of the Faith Center and started the renovation concept and ideas of the sanctuary, but they're not with us to see the completion. But they were still part of the foundation of this church. Do you sometimes feel like an invisible mom or dad? How do we break down the barriers between us and the world? What keeps us from seeing others and being seen by others? We need to go to places outside these walls, as wonderful as these walls are. We need to find ways to share God's love with people who are different from us, with the poor, with the oppressed, with the lost, with those who may have rejected Christianity, who have turned away from the church and need to be drawn back. We could take a little test this morning. Since I'm back in school, I'm a little more familiar with tests than I was a year ago. But this test doesn't require your laptop or a pen or paper. This test really just requires you to think about something. Think about your friends, as I think about mine. Think about the people we worship with, the people we work with, the people we play with. If we are honest, we would find, most likely, that they look a lot like we do. So I say to you, I need to broaden my circle. Yes, we need to broaden our circle of people that we encounter. We may even think these other people, the lost, the poor, we might really think of them as invisible people. But let's look from the other side. Maybe they may be looking at us as invisible Christians. Are we visible to the world? We must be present and we must speak. Just as the deaf man in the second story was healed, his witness was in his speaking. How do we learn to speak? We learn to speak from our parents, from teachers. We learn one word at a time. We learn sounds. Then we make words. Then we string words together to make sentences. And then we're off and running with our talking and speaking. But we need to be able to speak so that we can tell others what we know. What will happen to our world if we cannot speak and cannot tell others what we know? We need to know what our faith story is. What is our faith story? Well, first, I think it's really not so much our story as it is God's story. Our story is to give glory to God, to praise Him. And too often we make our stories more about us, about God serving us, and rather than us serving God. What is your story? There are lots of stories out there for us to find. If you're on Facebook or social media, read the newspaper, look online. There are all kinds of stories. Recently, I saw a story about Susan's sisters. Now, some of you know who Susan is. Her parents are Betty and Richard Thomason. I'm not sure if they're here this morning. But Susan was diagnosed with breast cancer. And her message that she has on Facebook and her sisters have is to spread the word about education, about mammograms and young women. She's in her 30s, so she is not the usual case, and she would not normally have had a mammogram, but she did. And her message is to save lives, but she's also a person of faith. Another story that some of you may recall, and some of you may not, in 1985, while I lived in Columbia, there was a young woman who was kidnapped from her driveway 2 days before she graduated from high school. I see some heads nodding. You may remember who that is. Sadly, she didn't survive this ordeal. But before she died, the kidnapper had her write a letter to her family. And if I remember correctly, the letter actually was part of the evidence that helped them capture the man who kidnapped her and later murdered her. But this young woman had a strong faith. And in this letter, she wrote to her family, "Please don't let this ruin your lives. Just keep living one day at a time for Jesus. Remember, everything works out for the good to those that love the Lord. Some good will come of this." Now, this is what the young woman wrote to her family. I suspect, or I know, that her sister and her parents probably did not, certainly on receiving that letter, and maybe even today, wonder how could something good come out of something that was so tragic. Well, her name was Sherry Smith. There's been, I think, a TV movie made. I don't know if they used their names. I can't remember. Her sister was Dawn, and I think she was in college at the time. She finished college, and she also was in the Miss South Carolina pageant, and she won, and she went on to the next level. But that's not really how she remembered her sister's life and her death. But Dawn started a ministry, and this ministry reaches out to others, and she takes her message of faith and her sister's faith to others. Now, I'm not suggesting that we put things on Facebook, but you can. And I'm not suggesting that we all go out and start our own ministry, but you could. What we do need to do is We need to be in fellowship with each other, at church and outside of church. We all need to spend time with God in prayer, in personal prayer with Him, listening for His voice. I'll plug the movie, War Room. I don't know if anyone's seen it or not. No one has. Well, it might be, there are a few. It might be worth seeing. Prayer is what it's about. I won't tell you more, but if you don't see it at the movie theater, maybe see it later. But spending time with God in prayer. Spend time reading the Word and studying the Word. We need to remember, though, that we have a story because of Jesus, and it is His story and its impact on our lives that is really our story. We do need to speak and be prepared to speak. And as we prepare to speak, we also need to be willing to listen and be ready when those openings come, where we can share our faith journey with those we encounter. Now, today, we're probably not going to build any cathedrals, but we are building God's kingdom one person at a time. Even if we do not see the results, we can trust that God sees. So I have a question for you this day to take home with you. Is God visible in your life? I will ask the same thing. Is God visible in my life? And a second question for you is, do others see God in you and in your story? And are you willing to share it? Let us pray. Dear gracious Lord, we thank You for the opportunity to share Your story with others. Lord, we are grateful for Your Son, Jesus Christ, and for all that it means to us, that we can trust You and that we can have forgiveness and we can give forgiveness to others. Lord, and most importantly, that we have the promise of life eternal. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us now stand and sing our hymn of dedication, number 367. He touched me. I'll share with you, Chuck, thank you for your part in our worship service this morning. The music was beautiful. It reminds me of my years growing up. My grandmother's small church didn't have an organ, had a piano, and they had a member who really played with lots of energy, and it was wonderful. Let us now go as children of God with the knowledge and the trust that Jesus has touched us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Amen.